3 minuten met een uitzending van vandaag, 27 januari 2019. Dus het bulletin van zondag. Ik moet improviseren, want ik heb mijn script niet voor me liggen. Wat hebben we vandaag? Today's bulletin will be almost completely in English. Daar begin ik mee. Het is bijna helemaal in het Engels vandaag. En verder heb ik het RRL-nieuws en ik heb Onno. En aan het eind van de uitzending heb ik 2 afbeeldingen in MFSK. Die kun je met FL Digi ontvangen. En daarna nog het script van het nieuws uit Australië. Dat heb ik ook wel eens gesproken gebracht. Ik heb dat nu in 8 PSK-1000 achter de 2 afbeeldingen geknoopt. Nou, dat is nog aardig gelukt ook, zonder dat ik het opgeschreven heb. 3 minuten met een uitzending voor vandaag.
This is ARRL Audio News, your weekly summary of news highlights from the world of amateur radio. If you retransmit audio news through a repeater, listen for the Morse code K character, followed by 4 seconds of silence. That's your cue to stop transmitting so that your repeater timer can reset.
I'm Carla Pereira, KC1HSX, and these are our stories for Friday, January 25th. At its annual meeting, January 18th and 19th, the ARRL Board of Directors decided that the organization needs to, quote, review, re-examine, and reappraise ARRL's regulatory and legislative policy with regard to private land use restrictions, unquote. In order to effectively undertake such a review, the board adopted a resolution to withdraw its December 18 petition for rulemaking to the FCC, which sought to amend the Part 97 amateur service rules to incorporate the provisions of the Amateur Radio Parity Act without prejudice to refiling. The resolution also is asking members of Congress who had refiled legislation to enact the Amateur Radio Parity Act to refrain from seeking to advance that legislation pending further input from the ARRL. Board members noted that the ARRL has been pursuing adoption of the Parity Act for the past several years, and that objective has not yet been achieved. While everyone understands that getting congressional approval on any matter can be a lengthy process, the difficulties getting the Parity Act approved has been a source of frustration to the organization and its members. A majority of the board now believes that there is a need to reassess the organization's approach to this issue. The board wants to make clear to its members and to those whose policies and conduct prevent or impair the right of U.S. amateur radio operators to operate from their homes that this pause is not and should not be interpreted as an abandonment of its efforts to obtain relief from private land use restrictions. The board noted that its intent is to renew, continue, and strengthen the ARRL's effort to achieve relief from such restrictions. This action represents a chance to get the best product possible for all U.S. amateur radio operators. The board expressed its sincere appreciation to the thousands of ARRL members who took the time to contact their representatives in Congress to urge them to support the Amateur Radio Parity Act. The board also offered its thanks to those members of Congress who have consistently and continuously supported the rights of U.S. amateur radio operators. The Caboolture Radio Club in Queensland, Australia, is now operating a beacon on 2200 meters at 137.44 kHz using the call sign VK4RBC. Australia's Telecommunications Authority, ACMA, has granted permission for continuous operation of the beacon using Whisper 2 plus a CW identifier. The power is 1 watt EIRP into a 500-meter wire at a maximum of 40 meters. Located in grid square QG62, the VK4RBC beacon also receives, which is unusual for a beacon, and it has copied signals from WH2XND, operated by Ron Douglas, NI7J, in Arizona. In the gaps between transmissions, it will report all Whisper decodes to WhisperNet. Equipment is an ICOM IC718 transceiver and monitor sensors TVTR2 2200 meter transverter running 50 watts. This is the first Australian beacon that has been granted permission to operate below 28 megahertz. The International Amateur Radio Union Region 1 Monitoring System, known as IARUMS, reports that an over-the-horizon radar located on Cyprus has been active on 21.170 MHz. The sovereign base of Akrotiri and Achillea is a British overseas territory on the island of Cyprus, said IARUMS Coordinator Wolf Hadel, DK2OM. The Ohio Pen DX or OPDX bulletin mailing list is reported to be in limbo after a January 11th hack of the hamnet.org server. OPDX bulletin editor Ted Mergliotta, KB8NW, reports that the server, which he'd been using since the late 1980s, was hacked and erased. The OPDX bulletin mailing list was among the casualties. According to Mergliotta, quote, "The OPDX mailing list is now in limbo, and I was told that the server hamnet.org is probably gone for good. I know this is going to be a big disappointment for these subscribers, as well as it has been for me, but after almost 29 years, I am considering possibly retiring from writing the bulletin." Unquote. Indonesian amateurs have received permission to operate on three new bands, 2200, 630, and 60 meters. The 60-meter band is at a maximum of 15 watts for advanced and general licensees only. All allocations are on a secondary basis.
And now with this week's satellite update, here's Bruce Page, KK5DO.
We spoke about the Nexus satellite launching last week. Hams are receiving the telemetry from the satellite and reporting to the data warehouse. On the same launch as Nexus, Origami Sat 1 also launched. Although origami has the traditional meaning of making things from paper, this acronym really means the OR from organization, of research, the G from group, on, A from advanced, deployable, the M from membrane, structures of, I from innovative, space science. Do not get too excited yet. Unless you have some microwave equipment, you will not be able to monitor the telemetry. It uses 5.8 gigahertz for high-speed downlink, which was used on FITSAT-1 back in 2013. This might be one of those neat experiments you want to get started with. The future of some satellites might be moving towards 5 gigahertz downlink and 10 gigahertz uplink. A benefit of this is much smaller antennas. This is Bruce Page, KK5DO, for the ARRL Audio News.
This is the ARRL Audio News propagation forecast for Friday, January 25th. We have a new sunspot to report, and it's boosted the solar flux index slightly up to 71. But don't get too excited. Not only is this a relatively weak sunspot, it's a cycle 24 sunspot. So sorry to say, we don't have any sunspots that herald the beginning of cycle 25, and of course that's what we're looking for. Our planet is cruising through a dense stream of solar particles at the moment, so we may see some disrupted conditions on the HF bands well into next week. On VHF and UHF, conditions were mediocre to poor last weekend for the ARRL-VHF contest. 6 meters provided some action for the FT8 operators, but nothing dramatic. In the days to come, coastal areas of California, Oregon, and Washington may see some openings on 2 meters and up.
And that concludes ARRL Audio News for this week. Our thanks to all contributors to this week's report. ARRL Audio News is produced by the American Radio Relay League, the National Association for Amateur Radio. For more information on amateur radio or the ARRL, visit us on the web at ARRL.org. You can also find us on Facebook and Twitter by searching for ARRL. If you have a question or comment about ARRL Audio News, email us at audionews@arrl.org. This program is copyright ARRL, all rights reserved. 73, and thanks for listening.
Foundations of Amateur Radio. Today I have a new call sign. It's exciting, special, kind of strange to be known as something other than VK6FLAB. It's hard to overstate how much of your identity as a radio amateur is linked to your call sign. It's a strange phenomenon to those who are not amateurs or who have only just joined the community and are still learning to remember what call sign they have. We think of call signs as semi-permanent fixtures, but realistically they're far from that. In your life as an amateur, you'll operate many call signs, even if you never change your own. When you're operating the local club station, you'll use that call sign. Or when you're participating in a special event, say an activation of an island or some remote DX station, or when you get on air to make noise in another country. Some stations use special contesting call signs, either for speed or to commemorate another amateur. There are those who collect call signs like badges, others only ever register one and keep it for the rest of their life. There are provisions for applying for call signs for short duty operation, sometimes as little as 24 hours to mark a significant event or activation. For example, in 2013 we registered Victor India 6 Papa Romeo Oscar Foxtrot, VI6 Prof, as a special call sign for the then Chief Scientist of Western Australia, Professor Lynn Beasley, who used that call sign for 2 hours after dinner during the annual conference held in VK6 that year. There are call signs registered for marking the end of polio, VI6 Polio, 100 years of the Wireless Institute of Australia, VI100WIA. VK100 Marconi commemorated the first direct wireless message from the UK to Australia. There are call signs registered for activating an island, like a Victor Kilo 6 Whiskey Delta India, to activate Woody Island between the 9th and the 12th of November 2012, or Victor Kilo 6 Charlie Hotel India for the Cheyenne Island activation in 2007. Special call signs are a global phenomenon. The Straight Key Century Club operates Kilo 3 Yankee. Kilo 1 Alpha gets used by amateurs throughout the USA for many different events, from Boy Scout camps through to the America Recycles Day, from the Georgia QSO party to the ARRL Field Day. The 2012 Olympic Games in the United Kingdom were celebrated with 2012 Lima and 2012 Whiskey call signs. Romeo Golf 22 Romeo Quebec was for the Winter Olympic Games in Sochi. As with anything rare, there's an active community that collects it. For special call signs, there are amateurs who collect by trying to make contact with an elusive call, confirm their contact, and receive a QSL card to decorate their shack with. In Australia, 3 times a year, on Australia Day, the 26th of January, on Anzac Day, the 25th of April, and on ITU Day, the 17th of May, a licensed amateur gets a special call sign to commemorate those special days in the calendar. Australia Day is the official national day of Australia, marking the anniversary of the 1788 arrival of the first fleet of British ships at Port Jackson. Anzac Day is the national day of remembrance in Australia and New Zealand that broadly commemorates all Australians and New Zealanders who served and died in all wars, conflicts, and peacekeeping operations. It's marked on the anniversary of the Anzac landing at Gallipoli in 1915. ITU Day is the World Telecommunication and Information Society Day, commemorating the foundation of the International Telecommunications Union on the 17th of May 1865. On each of these 3 dates, radio amateurs in Australia can replace their VK prefix with Alpha X-ray and use their special new call sign on air to make contact anywhere around the world. So, for now, I'm Ono, Alpha X-ray 6, Foxtrot Lima Alpha Bravo.
Daily Minutes zijn dagelijks vanaf ongeveer 1900 uur te beluisteren. De uitzending wordt een dag later om 10:30 ochtends herhaald. Alle mail is welkom op het adres x@xdv.me. Dat is ook te vinden rechts bovenaan de webpagina van de uitzendingen www.pa0ete.nl. De Daily Minutes toont iedere dag weer aan de hand van schokkende voorbeelden hoe een hobby mensenlevens kan veranderen. De internetfaciliteiten en studiohardware voor Daily Minutes worden gesponsord door 70MHzShop.nl. 70MHzShop.nl.
En microfoon naar retour.